Welcome back to True Believers in the Road to Hell. We're here with Sam Donaldson. Sam, we've been talking about the world, America's role in it, and so forth, and our kind of, or my lay opinions about some things, and your expert opinions on what you've learned. I want to return to the things you were talking about, though, in terms of the division in the country and the how you have said that these things have changed over the years, and the 30% of the country is has strong opinions of this and that, and wants to return to, I guess it's make America great again, is what you would say, but that kind of thing. But the divisions in the country and the tensions and the polarization, as it's called, and so forth. You've been in the media all this time. What role has the media played in these tensions?
Well, first of all, as I understood it when I was working, and I think people that I knew and admired in the so-called media, a term I never heard for the first several years. It was always ABC or CBS or the New York Times or the Dallas Morning News. It wasn't the media, as if it was one huge monolithic beast that was walking the land. But it's easier that way if you want to demonize the media, or as Richard Nixon tried to do, and so for a while successfully, use it as the enemy. Now, no one likes the news media. No one likes it. A reporter who comes knocking on the door said, wait a second, somebody said that you gave your brother-in-law, Mr. Mayor, the contract for asphalt laying. I mean, could we talk about, no. The mayor doesn't want to talk about that. And his normal defense is that's a lie. And no, and who are you? You're just out to play gotcha and all of those words. But basically the role of the media was, and I think still is, to bring information. Bring information to an audience of readers or listeners or viewers or what have you on the internet. And the information that can be checked out by a person who knows the business and is dedicated to trying to find facts is factual. And when it's not, you have to come back and say, I'm sorry, we made a mistake here.
And hasn't that changed? I mean, hasn't that really, really changed?
I'm telling you the way it used to be.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
People I'm talking about are the reporters and the editors of these major publications and major organizations. There was no internet. There was no cable. We're talking about, when I got in the business in Washington, three national television networks, and that was it. There were organizations, DuMont, but it was just three, ABC, CBS, and NBC. Once in a while, people would say to me, you know, you all lead with the same story and all that. I said, well, there's a reason, because that story happens to be the most important in the minds of people in our audience, and we bring them information about it. All right, fine, factual information. However, over the years, with technology being the advance guard, because nothing has changed in the way news was reported or the type of news that was reported to people in this country, that was not preceded by a technical ability to do something else. Cable. Hey, Fox News did not exist and would not exist if it weren't for cable. The internet, by the hundreds and maybe thousands of internet sites that you can go to discover that Holocaust was a myth, that those kids in Connecticut weren't actually killed. They were government plants. I mean, the most outlandish, ridiculous things. But if you tell something that's untrue long enough, it becomes fixed in the minds. I met a man named Wilfred Van Offen once in Buenos Aires, Argentina. I was on the way down to meet another man in the town of Bariloche. And Wilfred Van Offen was a lieutenant in the SS in Germany during the Nazi regime. And he was Joseph Goebbels' press agent. He said, well, Goebbels was the propaganda minister. He was the press agent for Nazism. That's right. And Goebbels had his own press agent. It was Wilfred Van Offen. And he explained to me what we all knew. What we did and what you do is you just tell something over and over and over and over again. And at the same time, you make certain that there is no alternative information that people then go to expose the lie. And people will believe anything and they will follow anything. Think of Donald J. Trump. He's still saying, I won the election. That's not true. That is not true. The people who ran the elections, Republican election judges, as well as Democrats, and 50 judges in courts, when Trump and his people tried to challenge the elections, said, okay, where's the evidence? Well, there's ballots dropped in the river. Do you have some pictures of that? Well, no, do you have someone who swear under oath of perjury that he saw it? No, but let me tell you, it happened. Well, no. But if you do it often enough, look what has happened to about 30% of people, the Republicans who will follow that lie and insist on doing it and are plotting even as we speak to install the types of election judges and monitors in several key states that will overturn, to use Mr. Trump's latest admission of what he was doing on January 6th, that he wanted Pence to do the vice president.
Well, we can agree, I think, you and I for sure can agree on the big lie and the Donald Trump's role in it and how he's, you know, I think I'm sure you and I have similar views on that. But I'm wondering about.
Yeah. You ask about the media.
About the media, right.
Information. And what happened to CNN, the man who's just now resigned as its boss, Jeff
Zucker.
Zucker helped bring Trump to the prominence that he gained. Zucker was a NBC executive who created The Apprentice and selected Donald Trump to say, you're fired. And presentation is everything. Not quite everything, but presentation beats factual material. I know I'm going, I keep wandering. Someone once told me that Albert Einstein, a man I never met, but was considered a genius, would be the last person you would invite to a dinner on Saturday night because he wasn't interesting unless he was talking X equals Y to the Z, seven bar and drawing the blackboard. He didn't talk about anything else. He wasn't interested in anything else, but you'd invite him because he was a genius. Well, here's Trump on The Apprentice making a name for himself. A con man, don't know that he can't pay his debts, doesn't pay his debts, sues everybody to make certain they don't get paid when he hires them. They don't know that. They see someone that's interesting. And of course, he denies all of the reality. And Deutsche Bank and others keep lending him money, which he can't pay back and doesn't pay back. The public doesn't know that. The media brings information, and Zucker put him on. Then when he became CNN, he would carry all of his rallies. And in fact, I wasn't there to see it, but someone said CNN would show you an empty podium and say, coming up in an hour on CNN, Donald J. Trump running for the presidency will be right there at that podium. Oh, my, I'm excited. So the media then began to lose its way. Yes, we bring information, but our job is not to promote somebody because he's interesting. That's entertainment's job. Make a Hollywood star, give him a movie. I mean, and of course, the ball player that knows how to not just swing the bat, but he's a character. We pay that man millions and millions of dollars. The nurse, you know, that saves our life, we don't want to give a raise to her. What's that about? Or the school teacher. Our values are all screwed up. So the media has lost its way in many senses. And then it started just pairing without comment because we don't want to be accused of taking sides. Well, yes, we do want to be accused of sides when it comes to preserving democracy in this country and the way of life that has benefited people but still needs to benefit many people who haven't achieved the ability to enjoy the fruits of our democracy as we have.
The media is You say, well, we have the media that shouldn't treat a politician like a rock star or like an athlete or that kind of thing, or shouldn't as entertainment, when exactly the opposite is true, isn't it? And that, you know, the nature of the business, the nature of the beast is that you want to get interest, you want to get ratings and at some level, and they're even if you're trying to do the right thing, right? So so there is an entertainment part. There's a horse race to politics constantly. There's constantly report on what the poll, whether the polls are up or down, whether or not this person is appealing to the African-American community or whatever demographic group. And they're constantly, they're going to focus on the person who is most entertaining. And the politicians have their data, their analytics, and their PR people to tell them how that entertainment is supposed to work. And it all goes hand in glove, doesn't it? That, I mean, it's not purely, surely you're not saying that if all the media can do is just put out pure factual information and then everything will fall in line.
I didn't say that's all the media can do, because clearly you've made a case that is there, that we do a lot of other stuff, some of which is not good for people, but then it's good for our ratings. It's good for the bottom line. Let me tell you something. For the first 10, 12, 14 years or maybe that I worked in Washington, these three networks, news departments, were not in any way controlled by the bosses. People would say, but then they tell you what to do, what to cover. No, because why? Because there was an understanding that our credibility depended on a certain amount of freedom to tell it like we think it is, like we found it. There was no need to. The bosses were making lots of money over daytime soaps and nighttime shows. All three of the networks, even ABC, which was laggard, was making tons of money. Finally, after cable reached the scene and began taking away our audiences, the bosses came to us in the mid-70s and said, boys and girls, a few girls were there, not many yet, it's time to make money. We can't have you as a lost leader anymore. So you've got to figure out a way to make some money for us. Well, how could you do that? I mean, we were telling the news that we think people should listen to, and you're right. If someone was interesting and they were also newsworthy, we could find. Well, we'd have to find something that a wider audience that didn't really watch us wanted, because we couldn't raise our rates. We had to lower our advertising rates because of the competition. So could we find a three-headed cow? Yes, we probably could, at least until we then, in the next episode of our newscast, brought you a scientist who debunked the idea there was a three-headed cow, and we could say, well, we've done it. It's like Trump, who said that Mr. Obama was not born in the United States.
Well, does it? That makes a point itself, doesn't it? That there's, I mean, I don't know what you do about it, but conflict is of great interest. People like, I mean, and the media creates or presents conflict frequently. They present the pro and the con of a particular point so that people will be more interested in the outcome.
We carried Trump saying in 2015 that Obama was not born in the United States. He didn't have any proof of that. He was demanding that Obama prove that he was born in the United States. And in your business, in the law, that's not the way it works, is it? If I accuse you of something, it's up to me to prove the something I'm accusing you of, not up to you to defend yourself against it.
Well, some people have a different view of that, but you're right that the legal system has, it operates by a certain set of rules that the First Amendment does not.
You're innocent until proven guilty in a proper court of law or a proper procedure. So we carried Trump constantly when he said, nah, Obama's not born in the United States, he's born in Kenya. Then the pressure on him got so great that he had to one day news conference to say, I have discovered that Trump is born in the United States. I have now put down this pernicious idea that he wasn't. Well, it was your idea. What are you talking about? He had it both ways. We carried that too. We finally got to, I'm no longer in the business. Finally, after you became president and the lie, one lie and one misstatement after another, you couldn't just say, I'm just here to carry what they say and check it and what have you. You're here to check it and you're here to counter it. And that's new. That's new in my business. That wasn't our job in my day.
My son, I told him I was going to be interviewing. I said, I'm going to be interviewing or talking to Sam Donaldson. And he goes, oh, really? I said, what do you think I should ask him? He says, ask him, how do we get back to a rational media? He said, now this is his perspective, but it's a common perspective.
I don't know. You mentioned the First Amendment. I basically agree with it. Although, as you know, there are exceptions that courts have found that I can't just say anything to anybody at any time for any reason and get away with it just because I have the right to open my mouth. But I do believe it basically. But we come to the point now, when I say I don't know, we've got to now somehow limit the ability of some of these people who actually, what they say results in the deaths of people. Their conspiratorial theories that people will buy. Here's a guy who's been told that there is in a pizza parlor in Washington, in the bowels of that parlor, Hillary Clinton is having children there for sexual purposes. This poor guy takes a rifle from one of the southern states and he comes up and he actually fires a shot in the foot. He is sincerely wanting to help those poor children. Well, wait a moment. I'm not certain that the people who are dispensing that garbage ought to be just allowed to, hey, tell anyone you want and let them bring their rifles. And they say, oh, that's we didn't say to do that. Yes, you did. Yes, you did when you tell people complete falsehoods that have the power to injure, not just defame.
What do you think the effect on government, actual governance, is of this type of media attention, media confusion, or conspiratorial theories, and all of the atmosphere that we have today? How does that affect government? Does government sift through it and make it better or make it worse?
Well, government used to have the media, no matter who was president, on its side. Not always. And of course, if you were a Democrat, the Chicago Tribune would editorialize against you, or the New York Herald Tribune or something, and vice versa. But basically, we trusted presidents. That ended with LBJ and Richard Nixon. And in my era, growing up in the business during those periods, we decided that everything had to be checked. If the president of the United States made a statement, you did not take it as face value. You didn't immediately say, well, that's a lie, because it probably wasn't, but you wanted to check it. Now, and people who invest their dreams on a politician and look up to that person, man or woman, they don't want to hear, of course, anything that suggests. When I covered Ronald Reagan, who was a polarizing figure, but a very strong figure, if I did a report which suggested he had done something wrong, not my opinion, but here are the facts, I would receive hate mail, you know, you vicious commie cur, you Democratic stooge. And of course, the Democrats then would say, thank God we have a reporter like you in the White House to keep old Bonzo straight. Because it was impossible to try to do it straight and have everybody like it. I mean, in my day, if you were in the news business and everybody liked you, you were a complete failure. In fact, you were a ninny. You had nothing to say of value.
Let's talk about you and your reporting, because you were famous, I think, famous or maybe infamous in some quarters for your scrappy, aggressive questioning. I remember a couple of specific things. One was, I remember you trying to yell at Ronald Reagan while the helicopter was going, because apparently Reagan had figured out that, or his staff had figured out that was the best thing to do if he was going to be asked hard questions, I think was the way it was seen. But you were yelling over the noise of the helicopter to Mr. President, what about Iran-Contra or whatever it was at the moment. And so I know that you had a reputation, right? I think it's a good thing, but you had a reputation for being very bullish, I guess you would say, and aggressive at your questioning. I do remember specifically one other thing was when Bill Clinton was introducing Ruth Bader Ginsburg. I think this is correct. You will correct me if I'm wrong. That he was introducing Ruth Bader Ginsburg as his nominee to the Supreme Court. And you asked a question of some sort, and I can't remember exactly what the question was, but it put him off on a speech of righteous indignation about how rude it was to be asking such a question. Am I right about that?
Oh, you're right about the question, but it wasn't me. It was my good friend, Britt Hume, who was at ABC at the time.
And okay.
That I'd left. Britt, of course, is with Fox now as an emeritus there. But when I came to Washington, everyone was polite. Everyone was civil. The presidential news conferences would have reporters say, well, Mr. President, sir, if you wouldn't mind telling us about your view of the bill. Even if you wouldn't mind, he was there to answer questions. So I decided when I came to the point where I had the opportunity to do things like that, wouldn't be rude, but I would ask a direct question that wanted a direct answer of something of public interest and importance. And sometimes it backfired. With Reagan, he knew how to handle it. One time during the early part of his first term, when we were still with 20% interest rates, Paul Volcker, the Fed chairman, was driving out inflation the old-fashioned way, jacking everything up, and he did. But it was not morning in America yet. And I said, Mr. President, when he called on me, tonight you blame this continuing recession on Congress and the mistakes of the past. Doesn't any of the blame belong to you? Yes, he said, for many years I was a Democrat. One time, Wallace or Andrea Mitchell, I can't remember which, said, what about the Mondale's charges? He said he ought to pay them. Well, all right, Reagan would go to the helicopter, and of course the blades are never whirring. Presidents, you don't want a blade that comes off and cuts off his head, but the motor was on. And he's hard of hearing, what? Until he heard a question that he wanted to answer, and he would run right over and he would answer it. Or else we're marginally smart enough not to keep yelling when he never, ever would come over. I mean, I don't have enough breath to do that. I thought you should be direct and you should try to require it. And I asked a lot of questions that the fan of a president, particular president, didn't like. But I used to tell people, questions don't hurt anyone. It's the answers that hurt. If I ask some silly question or one that's way off base, and the president or anyone else answers it to the satisfaction of the people who are watching, I'm the one who looks foolish. I haven't heard of. And if you don't think the president of the United States can handle a reporter, he shouldn't be president. So don't worry about Ronald Reagan being torn down, this poor man, by this man from New Mexico who's too big for his britches. Worry about it if no one ever asks a president or a county. Worry about that.
Do you have situations, Sam, where you, I mean, obviously you were in the business for so long and doing that for so long, and you had that reputation. Was there times that you regret going a little too far, maybe, or being too aggressive?
Yes, I've asked questions and I thought later it was a waste of time, of the president's time or someone's time, or it was off base. Or on occasion, I tried this not to happen often. My facts that were part of the question were wrong. You could say that, what have you. And I've asked some questions that were indelicate. And the worst question I ever asked a president, worst in the sense that I think we're talking about now, was to Bill Clinton. He called on me at a primetime news conference. And I said, sir, what was Broderick's first name? Juanita Broderick claims that you raped her. If that is not true, sir, what was your relationship with Ms. Broderick, if any? Well, he said he had escaped impeachment on another matter, conviction. He said, I've told the American people I'm not going to spend time talking about questions like that. I'm going to spend time working for the American people every day of what's left of my presidency. My attorney, David Kendall, has issued a statement on that matter. Well, now, okay, no one accused Mr. Kendall of rape, so I don't care what Mr. Kendall said. As he turned away, I said to him, "Can't you just deny it, sir?" "See my attorney," he said. "Well, I'm sorry, I had thought it was in the papers. She'd given an interview and all of this. It wasn't that I'd made up or found some woman who made this accusation. It was a news story. And the president, I thought, ought to speak to it. And if people watching wondered why he didn't deny it, that was their business and his for choosing the path of saying, my attorney has issued a statement and I'm going to serve the American people here every day and not answer questions like that. Make up your own mind, folks."
So, well, tell me more about why you thought in the end it was a, you regret the question.
I regret feeling that it was a legitimate question and I would ask it. I took no joy in accusing the President of the United States secondhand, meaning someone has made this accusation that you raped her. Now, what do you have to say about it? I took no joy in that. On the other hand, I think public servants, and particularly on these delicate issues, sex, LGBT matters, Q matters. When I say delicate issues, we're still fighting over how to approach it, what to say. I've watched politicians who were destroyed by the hint of a sexual indiscretion, and certainly by some proof, like happens to
Gary Hart, maybe.
Gary Hart, right. And then the next cycle, I thought that Jennifer Flowers, who came forward with audio tapes of her long relationship with Bill Clinton, who was running for the presidency, had destroyed his bill. No, no. Morris had changed. The American public said, that's okay. And as you saw then later on in Mr. Clinton's presidency, when the Monica Lewinsky affair arose, Democratic women, Senator Gillibrand from New York, defended him completely. Of course, when Governor Cuomo got in trouble, and perhaps rightly so, I'm not making a judgment now, got in trouble over a far less situation with women. Well, Senator Gillibrand led the fight against Governor Cuomo. Hey, girls and boys, just be consistent. If you have a principle, then try to enforce that principle fairly with everybody, not just against your enemies politically and for your friends politically.
Not to mention Al Franken, right? Who was, I think,
Al Franken, yes.
But one of the best examples, I think.
The Me Too generation is a great one. I think it's time that women had the opportunity not to be fearful of making an accusation about unwanted and sometimes criminal type conduct by men. I think I have no problem with that. And I think then men, not just Harvey Weinstein, who is the worst case example, should pay a consequence.
I was going to ask you about that in terms of relation to the media, because you mentioned earlier that, and of course it's true in most professions that, or many professions, that women were a very small part of the profession years ago, and they've grown and grown, and appropriately so, of course. But what is the, you've worked, in fact, now that I think about it, you've worked with some very strong, independent professional women over the course of your career, or at least that's my impression of them. And I think that's their reputation. For instance, you worked with Cokie Roberts, you worked with Diane Sawyer, you worked with Barbara Walters. These are all, you know, famously independent and strong, accomplished women.
Then and now, the greatest regard for all three of those women that you mentioned. They were all professional. They are smart, hardworking, everything you'd want in a man. That was in a woman. But for so many years, of course, females, with a few exceptions in the 50s and early 60s, and minorities, African-Americans. I worked for a station at first in Washington that hired the first African-American in the news business in that town at the stations that hired only whites.
I'm sorry, where was that?
Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
I was in Washington for 52 years as a reporter, the last 47 of which was with ABC News, but I worked for the Washington Post CBS station to begin with. But we came a long way. When I got started, there was no color television. There was no, it was all film. There was no videotape. There was no cable, no internet, no, and no women much. And today I say to young men, if you want to get in the business, meaning broadcast television news, good luck. Every town I go to, there used to be first a woman would be a co-anchor and everyone else men. Now, there are two women anchors. The weather person is a woman. The sports person is a woman. And you say, now, well, let's go to so-and-so. She's a woman. I'm telling you, I'm not exaggerating. Many places, women call it women's revenge, call it whatever you want. They've got the jobs. They work hard. So young man, I say, if you want to get in the business, you got to work 110% just to stay even like they did.
For centuries, yeah, right. What if you were king, how would you change the business?
I don't know. I've said that in answer to a couple of your attempts to get me to come up with a solution.
Come on, Sam.
The capability of so many people who are not trained, if you will, working reporters, working news people, men and women, to sift through information, to try to keep their values out of, their own values out of it when they bring you facts, is overwhelmed, is swamped by these sites that have this, not just foolishness, not just falsehood, but dangerous falsehood, that children commit suicide because they're told things which aren't true. I don't know what to do. I would not just let us change the First Amendment. It has five freedoms in there at the moment. And we'll take out freedom of speech or freedom of the press. No, I like the five freedoms and I want them all to prosper. But somehow, and I think the big start now is being made in Congress is control Facebook, control these large organizations that give people the ability to communicate with lies and dangerous material, have standards. If you want to come on and you want to have a Twitter account, then there are certain rules. You can't sit there and say, well, the election was stolen. Of course, everyone knows it, unless you have some proof. Everybody knows this. No, they don't know it, and you're not going to say it. Now, that's an infringement of what I guess the First Amendment would allow today, but not in a private organization. You can get on a soapbox on Boston Common or here in Albuquerque, or Las Cruces in the public square. But you have no right if I have a private company which disseminates information on accounts that you buy and pay me to achieve. You have no right to say, well, I'll say anything I want. If I say my rules are, you don't say this, you don't say that, you don't say something you can't prove.
Well, you're talking about, of course, the people who are giving the information. In terms of the people retrieving the information in your shoes, wonder what are the keys? You are an expert, and I mean, I'm serious. You are definitely an expert on interviewing people. You've done it for years. You've done it on national TV. You've done it in all kinds of settings of all kinds of people. So what are the keys to that? What do you think is the most important or the biggest challenge to having a good interview with someone you really want to get some legitimate information from?
That's basically two questions. What do you do about the victim, that is the viewer, if they don't receive the information you're sending because their mind is made up against it, they don't have the education to understand it, all of that. And the second is, how do you interview people? Well, you prepare it. You're ready to go. I once interviewed a man during the savings and loan crisis. In the late 80s, several savings and loan companies went broke. The regulators weren't on the job. They could evade the regulators and people lost their life savings and money that they'd invested. All right. So the guy who eventually lost money, the third biggest sum of money for people, was in Dallas. And we called him up and I'd like to interview you for Primetime Live program I was doing with Diane Sawyer. As people say, hey, he says, come on down. So the day I'm in the room, the cameras are set up. He's there with his lawyer. And the lawyer says to me and everyone in the room, I have advised my client not to do this interview. But he, of course, is the boss when it comes to what he wants to do. And he wants to do it. So did I do? So we start out. He said, now, Mr. Donaldson, you say that there people have accused me of committing a certain fraud the way we handle these accounts. I see you know nothing about Regulation Q, which is a regulation of the industry, a government regulation. We have followed it scrupulously, and Regulation Q is I don't know much about Regulation Q. So I change the subject. And I say, now, your daughter's wedding cost about $30,000, and you charged it to the savings and loan company. Why should stockholders in your savings loan company pay for your daughter's wedding? Well, it's a goodwill. Goodwill? I mean, you say you get business because your daughter gets married. That would appear to many people that you are taking advantage of your stockholders and you're improperly, Regulation Q, this, that, and the other. And now, sir, I said, is it not a fact that you in a private jet took the Catholic Archbishop of Dallas to Rome because he could arrange a private interview for you with the Pope? Well, you're against religion, Mr. Donaldson. I'm not against religion, sir. But again, tell us how the stockholders, your savings and loan, many of whom may not even be Catholic, benefited from that experience of yours. So we put the piece on the air. We talked a little bit on the air about Regulation Q, but we also, at the daughter's wedding, we had jet to Rome. And what do you think people thought? And I never took it out of context. We didn't edit it in a way. Everything you had to say about those subjects. You couldn't beat Mike Wallace if he was well prepared. And I'd like to say, if I'm well prepared in those days, you really don't beat me if in fact you have done these kinds of things. If I've made them up, you've got me.
But you're talking about things that it's like the old adage for lawyers that don't ask a question that you don't know the answer to. So you're asking questions of people about which you already know the answer. What if you are trying to actually get information?
I'm not asking someone to be interviewed for our program. If it's, you know, Mr. So-and-so, everyone keeps his nose clean, good citizen of the country. Now, I once instituted for Primetime Live, at the end of the show, heroes, just a little segment of people that have done good things, not just saved lives, but done good things for the community. The ratings fell off on that one. But when you have someone who clearly has played fast and loose with your money, like the stockholders of this savings and loan, that's who you want to talk to, and that's one you want to expose if, in fact, your information is correct.
What's the name of the person with the savings and loan thing?
The big one in Arizona.
Keating? Is that the person you were interviewing, Keating?
No, I can't remember the guy's name. It's the third
one. Oh, okay. In any event, whoever that was, his lawyer was right, you know. I mean,
his lawyer obviously knew there were problems. His lawyer was... defend the guy, obviously. The worst. I once asked someone just 3 days after Osama bin Laden was fingered as the guy who had organized what had just happened to us in this country, a well-known lawyer in Washington. I said, would you defend him if we capture him? And the guy gulped a little bit and said, yes, he's deserved. I would defend him to the extent of making certain that the system obeyed the rules of prosecution and obeyed the rules of evidence. In other words, that he got a fair trial. I wouldn't sit there and give a cheerful closing statement to the jury asking mercy for this man. But that's what you do. That's your job. And that's so the lawyer was saying to the savings and loan guy, he's going to get you. Because the lawyer knew about the daughter's wedding. The lawyer knew about the trip to Rome.
Well, there's a little bit of a conflict or a stressor, I guess, between your profession and mine. You're in the media business and you're an aggressive, scrappy questioner, a smart questioner, and you knew this information and so forth. Those types of things are dangerous and harmful to the legal system many times. Now, sometimes they're not. I mean, and so there's this tension between me going into court and having the proper evidence presented and making sure that we're following the rules of evidence and so forth, and the jury, if you will, seeing it on the TV screen when it's double hearsay or Sam Donaldson asking something that's might or might not be out of context. I'm not accusing you of being, but you know what I'm saying. I mean, it's just it's a whole different thing. And the media really prejudices legal proceedings on occasion. Would you agree?
We do, in the sense that if we get it wrong, that's a prejudice against the system working correctly. Or if the viewer, and I talked just a moment ago, I was about to, the viewer takes the information. Now, there's a reason why in important cases, maybe you've been in some of them, where the jury is sequestered. The judge says, I don't want this jury to be anywhere where they could forget the media, where they could talk to their next door neighbor or something. And if the jury is not sequestered, they are cautioned not to watch television news during the period.
Right.
Now, if you watch anyway, and we find it out, you can call for a mistrial. But the point is, we can't help it if we put something on the air we think is correct, even though it has an adverse impact on the trial, if the jury happens to hear it.
Really? I don't know. Is that right? That you say, well, we got to put it on there because the public wants to know? Is it because the public wants to know, or it's good for the system, or what? I mean,
Well, we're never going to be in a situation where the news media, again, is organizations, short of court order, obviously, in certain cases, and bought in some cases.
Unusual, yeah.
From saying what you believe you've uncovered as the facts in the case, even though the case has not yet been fully adjudicated.
Or if it uses for example, evidence that was suppressed because it was unconstitutionally seized or taken. If you have a confession from a fella that was beat out of him or something, and the confession comes out by ABC News, and then the juror said, you know, I mean, the problem is there aren't similar rules. I say it's the problem. The situation is we're working under different rules and different goals.
Any reporter that I knew would acknowledge that if rules of a court on a trial, and I guess basically we're talking about a criminal trial, but it could be any trial, sought to keep the people who would make the verdict, the jury, from being influenced by anything other than what was presented to them by the court and by the judge's instructions and all of that, I think we'd think that's a good thing. Well, I want the jury, if I'm ever on trial, I want a good lawyer, I want you, and I want the facts that you present on my behalf to be what they make their decision on. On the other hand, I can't keep other reporters and other news organizations out under the First Amendment, as you point out. We talked about that, simply because theoretically, in this case, it would be better if the system worked in silence, if the system worked in background, you know, in a dark room until time for the presentation to the public. That never works. That's not going to work.
I think they have some. I think there is some similar. I mean, I don't pretend to know the rules, but I think Canada has a little bit different system in that they do not allow public pronouncement of what the defendant is and so forth until after the trial, I think.
But Britain has that something long, I've never worked in Britain, along the same lines, but we don't.
Right.
And there have been several cases recently. The famous case where a black man was chased down by three men, one in a pickup truck, the other had a video camera, fortunately, for justice. And killed. And the prosecutor at the time did not charge anyone. Thought it was self-defense that these three men who were chasing down this black man and shot him and killed him were it's just a self-defense. Finally, the news media at that place was so persistent in digging out information. And the video presented that, as we saw, a jury of 11 whites and one black convicted all three of murder. Now, it's a good thing that someone other than the prosecutor, whose job was to prosecute crime, was on the scene. Yes. We know okay. why this.
Well, I'm very familiar. I'm very familiar with the case. Let me just full disclosure. One of the last podcast interviews I conducted was of Frank Hoag, who is was one of the defense lawyers in that case. And of course, he has a different view of it than you just described, and that the media presented and so forth. And of course, that's why we have courts, right?
Why we have defense lawyers. I wouldn't want a defense lawyer who said, you have no defense. Well, if he thinks that, they shouldn't. I mean, he should say, I can't take the case. But defense lawyers take the case, and I'll do the best I can for you. And he tries to present, I guess I've admired lawyers who can win cases and not break the rules. Edward Bennett Williams, famous lawyer, now deceased in Washington.
Right.
Had a case once. Big John Conway, the former governor of Texas.
The milk case, right?
Yeah, the milk case. The milk guy testifies. Conley's out of office now. The Nixon administration's over and all of that. And testifies that he went up with $10,000 in bills, cash, money, gave it to the Secretary of the Treasury, John Conley at the time, who put it in the safe, and it clearly was going to be an illegal contribution, and Conley was charged with it. So Ed said, well, you know, the guy tried to find something on him, tried to break his story. There was no other witness. He had no other background. So this was a District of Columbia case. The jury was mainly African-American. And into the room, just as it was being let go for lunch, in walked Joe Lewis, the Brown Bomber himself. Came over, threw his arm around John Conley. It looked like two friends they never met. But hey, there's no rule that said the former heavyweight champ so admired in the African-American. But Ed then put on a number of character witnesses. And the main one was a distinguished-looking white-haired gentleman. And Ed said, what is your name, sir? My name is the Reverend Dr. Billy Graham. And what is your profession, sir? My profession is to bring the word of a loving God to a sinful world. And Ed said later, when he heard two of the jurors go, amen, amen. It wasn't even a hung jury. He won.
Well, are you suggesting he shouldn't have won? That
justice was not done, except the jury is the, I don't have to tell you, the sole judge of the law and the fact that this man Conley was admired by Joe Lewis, by the Reverend Dr. Billy Graham. They weren't going to convict him of something about some $10,000.
Well, see, now you're denigrating my profession somewhat, as I denigrate yours a little bit. but let me ask you a specific question, which is kind of timely, which is media coverage of the Supreme Court. The federal courts have, of course, forever forbidden cameras in the courtroom, and the state courts have largely not. What is your view?
I want cameras in the courtroom. Justice Breyer, who just announced his appointment several years ago, he and I were talking about it, and I said, you should allow cameras in the Supreme Court. This idea that you must be sequestered from the public because it's more mysterious that way, and we will then follow your orders, your decisions, because we think you're some gods, is wrong. Let the public know why you make decisions by listening to the arguments and listening to the questions that you may ask, unless you're Justice Thomas, who never asked a question. He has asked two in the last 10 years. No, Breyer said, I'm for you, but I can tell you, you'll have no support of the court. And I certainly got none. Judges ought to be respected, like presidents ought to be respected. And judges ought to earn it the same way that presidents do, in the sense that not every decision I would agree with. For instance, we have a Supreme Court now that just a three-judge panel ordered the state of Alabama to redo the redistricting program that it had.
Supreme Court overruled them, yeah.
And the Supreme Court said, no, let it go forward. We will adjudicate it later. This court is going to put into effect many of the so-called conservative views on, certainly on social issues. Abortion is one of the big ones. I think it's not a social issue. I think it's an issue beyond a social issue, like should we burn the flag or not. It's going to rule, but it's not Earl Warren. It's not that court, which famously, beginning with segregation, but one man, one vote. You have to have a lawyer. You have to be provided a lawyer. The Miranda decisions brought, in my view, so many progressive ideas about the law and the citizens of this country and how the two should interact fairly. I thought Earl Warren and his court was a great court. And I've appreciated many justices since. And I'll reserve judgment on this court. We'll see.
Well, Sam, I'm going to let you go. I think that, let me ask you, what are you working on now, or what are your goals now for the immediate future?
I told you I'm 88. My goal is to keep going, keep kicking, if you will, but I'm not in the business. I'm doing an interview from time to time like this one, pro bono. I used to give speeches in my heyday for money, as long as it was not money from the Ku Klux Klan or from someone that I was covering or something like that. So I'm not doing much except gardening, taking care of the household, comforting my wife, who is still active on boards, and supporting her.
Are you involved in any of these issues we've talked about? I mean, I know you're not in the profession anymore.
I resigned all my boards and all of that many years ago. I feel passionately, as you and your viewers and listeners know, about certain topics. But except to give a little money. And to date, the people who have the Koch brothers and their money want to reform, they say, public education. And the opponents say they want to destroy it. Well, if I chose sides on that, I have a few hundred dollars I might give them. But the money I can give them makes no difference. I'll give a little money to Lynn Cheney, who I used to argue with on our ABC News Sunday roundtable.
Liz Cheney, you mean?
Liz.
Right. Liz, you said Lynn, I think.
Because of her stand, principle, and an effort to keep the Republican Party a fundamentally strong but mainstream conservative party. I was born a Republican. My mother was. I raised Republican. My first in politics was to help organize the Young Republicans Club of El Paso.
Are you registered one way or another now?
I am now.
I'm sorry?
Only I was in the business, I was not registered in either party. But I'm a registered Democrat now because a couple of years ago, I supported in the primary Jeff Apodaca for governor of New Mexico, meaning to get the primary. Our present governor, who won, beat Jeff handily. But I thought, if I'm going to publicly support Jeff Apodaca for the first time, support someone as a newsman no longer, I'm free to do that and not feel that I'm somehow showing that I'm prejudiced as a news reporter. If I'm going to do that, I got to vote for him. And I can't vote for him if I'm not a registered Democrat. So I'm a registered Democrat at the moment.
Would you agree that I'm going to take one more second to ask you a political question, because of course you don't know the answer to this, but I'm wondering if you agree with my supposition that Donald Trump is going to essentially destroy the Republican Party as we know it, and that it's going to have to find its footing some other way.
I don't agree, although I'm not going to put a lot of money on you. I don't agree for the following reason. You already see that Trump himself is crumbling. He's no longer on The Apprentice. He's no longer being carried by CNN. He's no longer has a Twitter account or a Facebook account because they're not allowing him to spread lies on their private organization. But Trumpism is the problem. That 30% still, when Trump a few weeks ago actually came out at a rally of his and said, yes, we should take the vaccines, he was booed. Not right. Everyone. But I mean, those people, they are set now to destroy our democracy, whether they understand what they're doing or not. They're set for an autocratic government with a dictator because they want their prejudices to be reflected in public policy. They want this country to be a country that maybe never was, but seemed to be again. And it's not going to be. It's going to be a country that moves with the population of the world and in all of the matters that the world worries about today as opposed to yesterday. And I don't know what to do about them. They're American citizens that I'm talking about. So they have a right to citizenship as much as I do. But you can't reach them. They're not watching us. Maybe, I don't think. Once they got onto the fact I am who I am, and then certainly began giving my views about Donald Trump and about authoritarianism, they have other things to do with their time than watch this idiot, meaning me, not you, Michael.
I understand. Well, I think we will, you know, we could debate this for a long time and we'll see what happens. But I've got my own views of how Trump will affect and splinter off and this and that. But
I think he's crumbling. Look at just straws in the wind. Here is the senior senator from South Carolina, Senator Graham, who all of his life is whatever benefits him, he's that side. He didn't. In 2015, you couldn't find any Republican official who was denouncing this idea that Donald J. Trump should be the party's nominee, stronger than Graham. He called him every name in the book.
Right.
Of course, when Trump became triumphant, Graham was his best friend. And then on January 6th, he said, I'm through with Trump. Because of that, everyone, McConnell, the Republican leader in the Senate,
McCarthy,
the House, McCarthy. Everyone denounced Trump as someone who had instigated in one way or the other, if by no other way, just tell him march on the Capitol. Now we know with documents being uncovered that it was a plot, a plan, well crafted, and Donald J. Trump was a spider at the center of it. So Graham now has said when Trump said, you know, if I get elected president again, I'll pardon some of those good Americans, you know, Americans being convicted of the crimes. And Graham said, I think it's wrong. And Trump said, well, if Graham said that,
he's a rhino.
Rhino in name only, meaning Republican name only, and he's wrong. And Graham then issued a wrong statement saying, no, we in our system, a statement that you would make or that anyone in his right mind would make about that episode. Then Pence comes along. Pence did the right thing, the vice president, against strong pressure to try to overturn the word that Trump himself used a few days ago to overturn the election. Not find the truth about the election, overturn it. That was Trump. He doesn't care about anything but himself. He doesn't care about anyone but himself. He doesn't care about anything but his ability to have power. He is. I'm not going to use names, but he is the guy that in history, this, that, and the other, is an autocrat who is a dictator, has brought ruin to his people. But I think Pence now, in front of the Federalist Society, a very strong conservative organization, not only defended himself once again as saying I had no choice, but as vice president under the Constitution, he said former President Trump is wrong, saying, in other words, voices not just Lynn Cheney, not just Gensinger, are speaking out. Mitt Romney's always been there. He voted to impeach, to convict Trump in one of Trump's impeachments.
I guess the only, we're in total agreement. I'm just saying that I think that the effect of that splinter is kind of the question or something we're going to have to wait for another day to figure out. But it's obviously going to have a disastrous effect one way or another, I think, but it's going to be interesting to follow.
Run again in 2024 and win the nomination, I think we'd be defeated. We are the majority. Now, we are the silent majority too often. lots of people who are really on our side, if it push comes to shove, they're not interested in this, they're not watching this, and they're busy with their own lives. But when it comes to it, you want a dictator, like fill in the blank, to tell this country what to do, what it can do, what you can do? Or do you want this freedom that we basically have under our Constitution, our system of laws, our criminal justice system, et cetera? They'll choose the latter. And if he runs, he'll be defeated. I join those, though, at the moment, who think he probably won't run, even if that he might win the nomination. So there's one thing in his life he can't stand is to lose.
I just fear that somebody equally bad will step into his shoes, but excuse me. But
someone equally bad has more ability than Trump.
That would be bad. Yeah.
They have a presentation. They have to be able to, as snake oil says, sell the rooms. He had that ability more than anyone I've ever known.
All right. Sam, let me tell you that, I've got notes here and subjects here. We could go on and on, and you've got so much information and so much experience. It's really wonderful that you have given us your time, and you've given us a lot of your valuable time. Thank you so much.
I checked you out.
I'm sorry?
You have a great reputation as a very able lawyer and member of the community of Las Cruces. I don't know everything about you, but I checked you. who is this guy? Do I want to talk to him? Yes. Yes. So don't come on about, oh, Sam. No.
No. Well, okay. Well, let's don't go on with that checking me out thing, but I just want to compliment you and thank you. That's all. Can't you take a compliment? Just let me talk for a second. I just think it's wonderful that you have all of this experience and perspective that you can share with us, and you're willing to do so. As you said, you're not getting paid, and there are lots of other things. Maybe we'll have another day where we can talk about some other things, but there is one other thing I'd like to let you know, and that is that there's a gentleman here in Mesilla, J. Paul Taylor, who maybe you know have heard of, who was also. You say you weren't born in Chamberino. He was born in Chamberino.
They used to live about a mile and a half from the farm where I was raised.
And he's been a subject of the podcast also, and he too is a wonderful gentleman. So, Sam, thank you very much for giving us your time, and we'll hopefully get together in person at some point, and perhaps we'll do this again. So that'll be...
I'm going to lunch. I've enjoyed being with you. Thank you for letting me spout off.
That's the end of this segment of True Believers and the Road to Hell.